Okay, my story today is a continuation of last week when we talked about the sanctuary. Mm-hmm. You remember that? Mm-hmm. And I'm going to cheat a little bit. I'm going to add a little bit of things in here for the adults too. But you can learn from all that, because this week I spent so much time reading about the sanctuary, and there's so many exciting things I didn't know what to leave out. So I had to leave out a lot. But anyway, remember that around this there was a court. Do you remember what color the curtains were? White. And there was a lot of curtains all around. And then this is the inside of the sanctuary that was inside the court. Now, remember that we learned, Rachel, you want to put that up on the desert? Put it on the desert part, because everything in the sanctuary pointed to one thing. Do you remember what that was? Jesus coming. And all points to when he was going to die on the cross for us. Everything. The sanctuary was a shadow of things to come. Now, you know something? Some people say, we don't need to study about the sanctuary anymore because all those things already happened. It was just pointing to when Jesus came, and he came already. But you know what? That's not really true, because the last part, the most holy place in the sanctuary, is where the priest goes on the Day of Atonement. And guess what? We live in the Day of Atonement now for real, not the shadow. So we should still be studying about that. The Day of Atonement's not over until Jesus comes. So we really need to be studying about all of those things. Now, we're going to put up, first of all, the division. You want to put that up? And Lori, help her to put that in the middle between the two rooms. And that was called the veil. And it was a very thick piece. It was as thick as a man's hand. So it couldn't tear very easy, could it? We have to remember that, because sometime later in our story, we're going to talk about the veil tearing. But it couldn't just tear very easy. And it was in the middle between the two rooms. And in the first room, there were three pieces of furniture. Now, the door to go in would be right down here on this end. And everybody that went in, only the priest could go in there. But when the priest went in, they went through the door. And which side is that table on? The right side? Well, you know, the tabernacle was made so that the back of the priest, when he went in the door, would be toward the east, the sun. Why do you think God told them to do that? Because he knew that people were going to start praying and to the sun. And they were going to start worshiping the sun. But when you worship something, do you put your back to it? No, you don't. You put your head to what you're going to worship. Well, God wanted the priests to always have their back to the sun. So he had it exactly in the right place. Now, I'm going to read you something else that tells something about Lucifer. because you see where that table is? That's on the north side, always on the side of the north. And you know what Satan said? When he was Satan, he wasn't Lucifer anymore because he wasn't the light bearer. This is what he said in his heart. I will ascend to heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mount of the congregation on the farther side of the north. Now, he wanted to sit where God sits, didn't he? So when he says he wanted to sit on the side of the north, he wanted to take God's place. So God put something on the side of the north that's very important to remember about. And we'll talk about that later sometime too. But there was something on the table. You want to put these up there? What was it? Do you remember? Bread. 12 loaves of bread. And you know, they put that on there every Sabbath. And that called attention to the people, all the people, because the priests, they baked new bread, and then on Sabbath, they took the old 12 loaves off, and they put the new 12 loaves on. How come do they have 12, do you think? Good for you, the 12 tribes. There was one loaf of bread for every tribe. And do you know why God had them put that there? Because when they came, they were acknowledging and thanking God for the sun and the seeds and the ability to grow food. It was called the bread of the presence. And do you know what it represented? How did it represent Jesus? Who's Jesus? The bread of life. Yes. And that represented that. And it was very important. And do you know they put it on there every Sabbath? Because that helped all the people to remember that Sabbath is very, very special to God and very holy. All right, then there's something else on the other side of the room. Do you see what that is? It's a candlestick. And do you know, and the table was made of acacia wood. Acacia wood is very hard. It's very beautiful, but it doesn't ever get old at near as fast as most things do. And it doesn't rot. And it was covered with gold. Can you imagine how beautiful that was? And everything on that table that they used was made out of gold. Gold utensils, gold dishes, because also there was some good-smelling incense on that table, too. Well, then the candlestick, but you know, the candlestick wasn't made out of wood. It was all made out of gold. Can you imagine how expensive that would have been today? It was expensive even then. Everything on it was made of gold, and it had little places to put something to burn. You know what they burned? Olive oil. And what does that represent? The Holy Spirit. Yes. And the Holy Spirit has to be there, you know. And when we let our light shine, like that light, it's because the Holy Spirit is there. It's the light of the world. And there's something else about that. You know how often they came in there and changed those every morning and every evening. Does that remind us we should have our morning worship, morning and evening? Okay, then there was another piece of furniture, Olivia. You want to put that up there? It was in the middle. It's kind of hard to put it in the right place, but it was in the middle. It was in the middle between the two, right in front of the veil, and that was the altar of incense. And you know what that represented? The incense represents our prayers. And they go up to God. And you know, the incense on that altar, the priest didn't like that fire. You know where that fire came from? Out in the outside in the court, the sacrifice, big altar that they burned the sacrifice on, when they first started building it all, the fire came down from heaven. He sent the fire. And the fire on the incense, the priests had to get the fire from that other fire. They couldn't bring just any fire in there. You know, they did that one time and something really terrible happened to them, to the people who did that. They had to have it with that special fire that came from God. And there's a lot of other things we'll learn about those altars, but I can't tell everything. Well, in the second altar, in the second most holy place, why don't you take those other things down so we can see. You can see the Ark of the Covenant. Now, what was in there? You girls know what was in there, remember? Yes. Inside there was three things. Do you remember what the most important thing is? Put this up there in front of it, and it can remind you. The things that were inside. Oh, the Ten Commandments that God wrote with his own finger. And there was something else in there, that a miracle that happened every day. A bowl of the manna, a pot of manna that came down was in there to remind the people. And you know, there was almost two quarts of manna that they put in there, and something else they put in there. Aaron's rod that budded. You remember about that? Yes. And those two things, they're not in wherever that is anymore, but something special happened to them. I'll talk about that another time. Well, that special Ark of the Covenant had a solid gold top to it. Solid gold. And that was called the Shekinah. You know what Shekinah means? When I heard this, I couldn't believe. It means the resting place of God. Just imagine that. Now, when you learn about the tabernacle, you learn that in there was so bright because it was God's presence. Can you imagine that? Oh, my. When I thought about that, it just almost made me cry. That, do you know something that I didn't think about that until I was reading about this? That Jesus hadn't taken man's human nature yet, had he, at that time? He wasn't a man. He hadn't become like a man and been born down here again. So, oh my, people couldn't see him. People couldn't look at him then. No, because he was so holy. He's still holy, but now he took man's nature, and we were able to see him. People were able to see him. But before that, oh, he was so They couldn't see him, but you know what? God wanted to be with his people. He wanted so badly to be with his people that he said, I'm going to come down there and I'm going to stay with them in the tabernacle. Oh, wow. And do you know that even at night, when the people were in their tents, they could see the light. They could see the light down there. Think how that made them feel. They could look and know God himself is with us. He is in the tabernacle. Oh, wow, that is so wonderful to think about. You know, we need to really think more about it, don't we? Because God is, he loves us so much, and that's why he did all those things. How wonderful is it? So I know this is kind of long, so I'm going to have to stop. But next week, we're going to talk about the priests, because the priests had a very, very special job. So you know what? All of you, if you get a chance at all, read more about the sanctuary, because I'm telling you, it'll make you think differently about God. It will make you think differently than you automatically think about God. Will you do that this week? Thank you.
Now it is our time to sing our call to prayer song. And if you'd like to come up to the altar this morning and give it to Jesus, maybe you have something heavy on your heart, maybe you just a praise report, you'd like to give it to Jesus, the altar is open this morning. Come on up as we sing our song. He is here. Hallelujah.
He is here, hallelujah. He is here, amen. He is here, holy, holy. I will bless his holy name. He is here, listening closely, hear him call.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you and give you the praise this morning for being here. Thank you for allowing us to live in the land of the freedom, that we can come and worship you as we please. We can sing your name. We can teach and preach from your word without being afraid of being arrested or even being killed. We thank you, Lord, for giving us this grand opportunity to come here this morning to give praises to your name through song. We pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would be here amongst us, touching our hearts, impressing upon our minds the changes that we need. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for giving us the protection throughout this week. We know that Satan is mad and he is angry at us, because we claim to be followers of you. We try to imitate you because, Lord, actually, you live within us. We are the salt of the earth. We are the light to the world. Thank you for protecting us from those evil forces. This morning, Father, we just thank you for giving us this dear sister who has come to the altar. Regardless of whether it's a praise, Father, or whether it's something heavy upon her heart, we pray, Father, that your spirit will rest upon her mightily. That, Lord, that you will give her the peace of mind, that you give her strength to go on and carry on your work throughout this week. We thank you in the name of the most powerful name on earth, that is the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. This morning, I am going to take the back seat, and I'm going to stay in the background. Thank you for each and every one of you who has volunteered to take part in today's service. I appreciate it greatly. We're going to start out with a hymn of praise, but there's one thing first I need to say, and mostly it's to Gabriella. But it's to everybody here. Don't laugh at me, please. Va, Ubek. Vas, Ubek. Ah. And sermon in Southern terminology, that was Romanian for as. As every group, not one individual, but for the group, I love you. Robert been trying to teach me Romanian this morning. I figure I'll make a fool out of myself, but I give it the very, very best. All right. We're going to start out with Mr. Jeff. He's going to read us A Tale of Two Sisters, and then we're going to sing Nearer, My God, to Thee. Then Renee is going to read us Yield to the Hand of the Master. Then Robert is going to give us the answer to the call. Then Thomas will read us Focus on Faith after the songs.
A Tale of Two Sisters. Sarah Flower Adams, the author of this well-loved hymn, was a woman of arts. At an early age, she followed her dreams of being an actress and traveled from her home in Harlow, England, to the London stage, where she played the part of Lady Macbeth in Shakespearean productions. Plagued with delicate health, however, Sarah Flower found the rigors of theatrical life exhausting, and she made a decision to channel her creative talents along literary lines. Returning home, she turned her efforts to composing poetry and prose as well as hymn texts for use of the Unitarian congregation of which she was a member. Her sister, Eliza, was an accomplished musician and composed in music for many of Sarah's verses. In 1834, at the age of 29, Sarah married John Bridges Adams, a prominent civil engineer and inventor. Together, they established a lovely home in London where they entertained a wide circle of devoted friends. Despite her increased social obligations, Sarah continued to work with her sister composing hymns. Their pastor, the Reverend William Johnson Fox, recognizing the literary and musical gifts of the two talented sisters, enlisted their aid in compiling a new hymnal for his congregation. The project was nearing completion in 1841 when Reverend Fox lamented that he could not find a suitable hymn to use at the conclusion of a sermon he was preparing on the text found in Genesis 28, 10 through 22. In this passage, Jacob is fleeing from his home. On his journey, he stops to spend the night in the desert. Using a stone for a pillow, he falls into a deep sleep during which he has a vivid dream. In the dream, Jacob sees a stairway or ladder extending from earth to heaven, and with the angels of God descending and ascending upon it. Above the ladder, Jacob sees a vision of God. Waking from the dream, Jacob recommits his life to God and renames the place Bethel, House of God. As Reverend Fox spoke of the need to find a hymn to accompany his sermon on this text, Eliza encouraged her sister to compose a verse on the subject. Taking the challenge, Sarah sat down that day and read and reread the story of Jacob's dream. As she absorbed the details of the Bible passage, she transferred them into poetic form. When the five stanzas were completed, she had captured the essence of Jacob's dream in her hymn text. She had included the stony pillow in verse 2, the angelic stairway in verse 3, and the naming of the site as Bethel in verse 4. Eliza wrote a melody for his sister's words, and their new hymn was published in Reverend Fox's hymnal, Hymns and Anthems, in 1841, 3 years later, Nearer My God to Thee was first sung in the United States. Although it had a cordial reception, it did not really gain much popularity until the words set to a new melody in 1856. This melody, by which we know the hymn today, was composed by Lowell Mason, a prolific writer of church and school music. Neither Sarah nor her sister Eliza lived to see the hymn gain worldwide acclaim, for within 5 years of its publication, both women became victims of tuberculosis. It is a fitting tribute to them both that, as the following two stories attest, this beautiful hymn has been a comfort to men and women of faith for over 150 years. President of the United States, William McKinley, lay dying from assassin's bullet in 1901 when he was heard by his family to whisper the chorus of this favorite hymn, Nearer My God to Thee, Nearer to Thee. A few days later, at his funeral and memorial services around the country, congregations sang the hymn, remembering as they did their fallen leader. The second story occurred as the lifeboats pulled away from the sinking Titanic on the night of April 14, 1912. Over 1,500 people, unable to enter lifeboats or obtain life belts, stood on the shuddering deck facing death. As they did so, the ship's band played this hymn and hundreds of voices rose over the roaring ocean affirming what, for them, was deep reality. Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee.
How many verses? Do you want all the verses, Sean?
First, third, and fifth,
okay. That's 473.
Nearer to thee. yielded to the hands of the master, of their master. Adeline Pollard sat in a church prayer meeting in 1902, a depressed and discouraged Christian. Her whole life had been spent in efforts to teach the gospel of Jesus Christ, and her heart's desire had long been to travel to Africa to minister to those who had never had an opportunity to hear such a message. Just when it seemed that things were falling into place for the accomplishment of this dream, she received word that her financial support had not been provided and that she would not be going to Africa after all. To Adeline, now 40 years old and still single, it seemed the final blow in a lifelong string of disappointments. She had gifts of teaching and writing, but had been unable to use them in the way she most desired. She had great dreams and ideas for ministering tirelessly for the Lord, yet her body was plagued with weakness caused by diabetes. She despaired of ever accomplishing something fulfilling and meaningful. It was at this point that she decided to attend a prayer meeting and found herself sitting beside a frail and elderly woman whom she had never seen before. As prayers were offered and requests were made for blessings, direction, and other gifts from the Lord, Adeline sat in silence, unable to utter a prayer from her aching heart. It was then that the woman next to her offered a simple sentence that was to give Adeline new hope. She said, "It really does not matter just what you do with us. Lord, have your way with our lives." The words burned in Adeline's mind. Suddenly, she realized her whole life had been spent pursuing her own goals, doing what she wanted to do for God and taking little time to seek what he might have her to do. As she walked home from the prayer meeting, her step had a wonderful new lightness. Arriving home, she opened her Bible to the Old Testament book of Jeremiah. In the first four verses of the 18th chapter, she read these words. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, "Arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words." Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels, and a vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again. Another vessel seemed good to the potter to make it. Adeline saw herself as the defective pot, needing to be broken and reformed by the master potter after his will. As she meditated upon this thought, the words of a hymn poem began to form in her mind. Before she went to bed that night, she had composed all four verses of the popular hymn, "Have Thine Own Way, Lord." It was after this turning point in her life that Adeline Pollard's teaching and speaking ministry took on a new dimension. She worked for several years educating missionaries at the missionary training school at NAC on the Hudson. She also spent time as an itinerant Bible teacher, and lecturer. And she eventually did have an opportunity to go to Africa shortly before World War I. When the war broke out, however, she went to Scotland and continued her missionary efforts there. At the end of the war years, she returned to the United States and traveled extensively in the New England states, teaching the Bible despite her failing health. On December 20th, 1934, at the age of 72, Adeline Pollard died of a heart attack. True to the missionary zeal that marked her life, she was not at home in bed when this happened, but in a New York railway station, waiting to board a train for Philadelphia, where she was planning to speak. Although she wrote other hymns, "Have Thine Own Way, Lord," is the only one still in popular use today. Perhaps that is fitting, for it was not only her philosophy of life, but her most accurate epitaph.
Amen.
That's hymn number 567.
Answering the call. Music was always an important part of James Milton Black's life. And from an early age, he demonstrated not only an avid interest, but also an aptitude for composing, playing, and singing. Born at South Hill, New York, on August 19, 1856, young James was educated in the arts of singing and playing the organ. After completing his formal education, Block became a teacher of singing schools. He traveled around the countryside, stopping in small towns and villages where he would enroll local students for a week or two in his singing courses. As the lessons progressed, Block introduced his students to the rudiments of musical interpretation, including sight reading, conducting, and choral singing. At the end of the course, a recital would be held and the students would demonstrate their musical abilities before the entire community. In addition to his successful singing, schools, James Black worked as an editor of gospel songbooks. The books he edited were then published by either the Methodist Book Concerns or the Hallmark Company in Philadelphia. One of his collections, Songs of the Soul, published in 1894, was extremely popular, selling over 400,000 copies in its first 2 years of publication. Although not a member of the clergy, James Black took an active part in the life of his home church, the Williamsport, Pennsylvania Methodist Church. There he taught Sunday school and was the president of the Young People's Society. He found great joy in ministering to the youth in the community and often spent much time and energy encouraging young persons who had unhappy or difficult home situations. Thus it was that Block became a friend and counselor to a 14-year-old girl who had the misfortune to be the daughter of the town drunkard. He encouraged her to attend Sunday school and to join the Young People Society, where she soon became a regular attendee and faithful believer. Block encourages young students to memorize scripture verses and frequently require them to recite a favorite verse from the Bible in answer to the roll call at the weekly youth meetings. One week, when the name of the young girl in whom he had taken a special interest was called, there was no response. Her absence sparked a spiritual application in Block's mind, and he took advantage of the situation to make reference to a passage from chapter 20 of the book of Revelation, which speaks of the Lamb's book of life. He told his students what a sad thing it would be when the names are called from the heavenly book if anyone were absent. Concluding his remarks, he cried, "O God, when my own name is called up yonder, may I be there to respond." As he walked home that evening after the church meeting, James Block could not rid his mind of those words and wished he had known a song he might have used to impress his young congregation with the importance of being at that heavenly roll call. The words, "Why don't you make it?" seemed to echo in his mind. Block was completely preoccupied with thoughts of such a song as he entered his home. When his wife commented on his troubled expression, he made no reply. The verses were already beginning to take form. Block went to his desk, set pen to paper, and within 15 minutes had written all three verses of the song. Taking the stanzas to the piano, he reports that he sat down, put his fingers on the keys, and played the music out from beginning to end. Later in his life, he was quoted as saying, "I have never dared to change a single word or a note of the piece since." As a poignant postscript to the story, Block was saddened to learn that his young friend was absent from the meeting because of illness, diagnosed a few days later as pneumonia. Within 2 weeks, she had died.
That's hymn number 216.
Shall gather over on the other shore, and When Helen Limmel was only 12 years old, her family moved from England to America. Her father was a Wesleyan Methodist pastor determined to strike out in a new area of ministry. After a brief time in Mississippi, he moved his family to Wisconsin, where they settled. Even at this young age, Helen showed remarkable musical gifts, and her parents saw to it that she received voice lessons from the finest teachers. After she had finished school, Helen traveled to Germany for further vocal training and studied there for 4 years. Returning to Wisconsin, Limmel launched a ministry of her own, giving concerts in auditoriums and churches across the Midwest. She was also a member of a women's quartet that traveled on the Chautauqua circuit, bringing concerts to small rural towns and villages that would otherwise have no opportunity to hear quality performers. Although talented enough to succeed as a professional singer, Helen Limmel sought fulfillment using her musical gifts as a form of ministry to God. She joined the faculty of the Moody Bible Institute, teaching vocal music. She served in this capacity at both their Chicago and Los Angeles campuses. It was in the year 1918 of our Lord, when she was 54 years old, that Helen Limmel wrote the beautiful and challenging hymn, "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus." She had been visiting with a missionary friend who had shared with her a gospel tract by Lilias Trotter titled "Focused." The pamphlet included the statement, "So then, turn your eyes upon him. Look full into his face, and you will find that things of earth will acquire a strange new dimness." The words seemed to repeat themselves over and over in her mind during the following week. In her memoirs, she reports the following: "Suddenly, as if commanded to stop and listen, I stood still, and singing in my soul and spirit was the chorus, with not one conscious moment of putting word to word to make rhyme or note to note to make melody. The verses were written the same week, after the usual manner of composition, but nonetheless dictated by the Holy Spirit." The song was published in 1922 by the British National Sunday School Union in a book called Glad Songs, which contained 66 other songs by Helen Limmel and were used extensively by the Keswick Bible Conference. It was at this conference that "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus" first gained popularity as a hymn of invitation and dedication to the life of a deeper commitment to Christ. 2 years later, the hymn was first published in the United States and has since been included in most evangelical hymnals.
It's hymn number 290, Beautiful Stories for Beautiful Hymns. Let's stand as we sing this as our closing song.
Life more. Thank you for everyone who participated, especially our musicians. Couldn't do it without you. I'd like to leave you with a word from the word of the Lord. Psalms chapter 33 said, "Let the godly sing for joy to the Lord. It is fitting for the pure to praise him. Praise the Lord with melodies of the lyre. Make music for him on the 10-stringed harp. Sing a new song of praise to him. Play skillfully on the harp and sing with joy. For the word of the Lord holds true, and we can trust everything he does. For he loves whatever is just and good. The unfailing love of the Lord fills the earth." And my friends, the unfailing love of the Lord has filled this church this morning. I do believe it. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for giving us this opportunity to come and sing praises for you. Not only are we just singing praises by ourselves, Lord, but the courts of heaven was here singing along with us. And Lord, we thank you for being here. Now please go with us as we go our separate ways. And may we all return safely next week to study and to fellowship with like believers. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.